In today's video, we're going to discuss the number one question I most likely get on a daily basis. Dan, should I buy now or should I rent and wait for rates to come down and the housing prices to come down? So let's dissect that. So the first common denominator on all this is the Federal Reserve. So why are rates where they are? The Federal Reserve. What has put a damper on the housing market? The Federal Reserve. What has crashed the stock market back last year and now we're on a rally this year? The Federal Reserve. So that's what we're going to talk about in today's video. My name is Dan Free. I do this report every day and inform you guys out there what's going on in real estate. We're going to focus in on today is when I think FOMO will enter back into the housing market. So let's get to the data that we're seeing today. Real inflation could actually be 2.78%. So let's go over. We had reports today of the PCE. Now the PCE, let's get to that indicator right now. Federal Reserve's preferred gauge shows lowest annual inflation since April of 2021. And then you're going to see core PCE inflation declines to 4.5. And you're going to see all this stuff about the PCE. So what the heck is the PCE? So let's get over to this. The PCE is actually this. The PCE price index released each month in the personal income and outlay report reflects changes in the prices of goods and services purchased by consumers in the United States quarterly and annually. So let's look at this report. In February, that number came in at 5%. But remember just a year ago, this number was 9. Okay, so let's pay attention to what's going on here. In February, it was 5. In March, it was 4.2. In April, there was an anomaly and everybody's like, oh, here we go again. Inflation's raising its ugly head again. So the markets got spooked and then the Federal Reserve did what they did and everything else. So what is it now? 3.8. So let me go into this and just dissect this a little bit for you. In regards to the PCE, let's get over to a caption that I have right through here. The PCE, how the Federal Reserve actually figures out what the housing cost or index is in this is the one basically conundrum that none of us and the economists can figure out where they get this number. It's a lagging indicating number and it's way old. So if they actually use current data, the rate, inflation rate should be about, well, 2.78%. So the details are this, and I highlighted just the main section down here. The Bureau of Labor Statistics doesn't use mortgage payments to estimate homeowners' costs because it's considered those to be an investment, not a consumption cost. Instead, it measures the rental cost in the area and then calculates OER, the amount of rents that homeowners are giving up by living in the house instead of renting it out. So you can see right below there. If this doesn't make sense to you, you're not alone. So what they do is they figure out what housing prices or costs would be for you guys if you continued to rent out there and what that number is doing. Well, just this week, we had the report showing that rents are down 8.6 nationally. Okay. Well, this report that the Federal Reserve is still using has the number considerably higher than that. So why we're really hampering on this is the housing number in the PCE and the CPI and all the inflation reports that the Federal Reserve gives out has actually shown since July of 2022 to now, rental prices or the housing prices are down, I won't say housing prices, the housing cost factor in the PCE is down 8.6%. Now the Federal Reserve has not, their numbers do not reflect this yet. So that's how all the reports, such as even myself, are saying, guys, inflation's really at this level. Now you guys might say, well, you know, eggs are still high, groceries are still high, my utility bills are still high, but just let's reflect back about a year ago. What was gas prices? $6? What are they now? $3? Okay, oil is considerably down. Lumber's considerably down. That's why home builders, they're actually able to discount their home prices without hitting their bottom line because a lot of their raw materials have actually declined in value. So their profit margins are actually spreading even though they're selling fewer homes. Think about that one. Okay, so that's what's going on right now in the inflation front. So let's go over here and just look at how the markets are reacting to this number. And this number only, we see the S&P up over 1%. Then we go to the Dow Jones, it's up almost 300 points. We got the NASDAQ over 200 points up. So we're starting to see inflation. So what you can see now is, well, as inflation starts to cool, the markets are going to love this. Now, another piece of this equation is the jobs market. Now, the jobs market, we're in unprecedented territories. Like President Biden was out yesterday saying he was the president that created the most jobs ever in history. Well, if you actually look at that, it's true. That's really skewed. We went through COVID and basically everybody got furloughed or lost their job or something else. So the employment numbers actually just plummeted. Okay. Then what happened from there? We came off a complete bottom and have come up. Job growth, we're not much higher than where we were in 2019 pre-pandemic. So yes, is it true that there's, you know, 13 million jobs added while President Biden was in office? Yes. Is it, should he get all the credit for that? Well, no, because people just went back because COVID relief was lifted and you can go back to work. So who can take credit for that? Really nobody. Okay, so that's what we're seeing right now in there. So let's get over to the headline news. And all we have out today is the PCE numbers. So let's reflect through here. PCE numbers, this is gonna actually match the report that we just went over. We have the core PCE month over month was supposed to, or the previous report came in at 0.4. The expected 0.3 came in right on the button. Now, here's the surprising piece. The core PCE over the year went from 4.7. They predicted 4.7. It came in at 4.6. Might not sound like a big move, but it's pretty good. It's helping the markets. So let's see what this numbers and all this data coming out today is doing for this, the futures market on what the Federal Reserve is going to do at their next meeting. Because what we're trying to figure out is the Federal Reserve is meeting in about 3 or 4 weeks. Are they going to raise rates again? Are they going to start that, you know, pumping up rates again and again and again to cure inflation? I hope not. But the markets are telling us this. So what we do is we go over to the CME. And what that is, the Chicago Mercantile Exchange, which you're seeing right here. And what this number is what is the likelihood that the Federal Reserve will change the federal target rate at the upcoming meeting? So right now, the federal funds rate is at 5.25. So here's what we're seeing. Federal funds futures, you can see through here. You're down through here. The market's meeting probabilities of what they're going to do. You go across here, the July meeting. They're meeting on July, what does that say, 26th. You go across. Right now, federal funds rate, like I said, is 5 to 5.25. We're right in this range here. We're in the yellow. There is now an 85% probability that the Federal Reserve is going to raise rates another 0.25% in the July meeting. If they don't do it in July, they're going to do it at some part of 2023. Now, can that be actually come into play? I think the July might come into play, but we're going to have a lot of data to that point. So I wouldn't be surprised if I know the Federal Reserve is coming out and saying, well, we're not taking out multiple rate increases this year. Well, don't be surprised if they're just saying that and they're going to monitor these numbers to see, well, inflation's actually really cooling down. Maybe we could pause again. But the concern I have with that, and a lot of economists have with that, is if they come in and don't do rate hikes again, the markets are going to say, okay, it's over. We won. So the stock market's going to rise. Mortgage rates are going to get better. And then we're going to be back to where we were maybe 2021. That's what the Federal Reserve is really strongly trying to defend against. Because let me answer the number one question I get on a daily basis. Dan, should I buy now or rent waiting for a housing crash and mortgage rates to come down? Okay, so let me address that real briefly. So if your question is that, that's probably the number one question I get on a daily basis. So here's what I'm going to say in reflection to that. If you're looking to buy or rent, that's not a decision for me or the news or mainstream media answer for you guys. If you're in the position to buy, such as this, your finances are in line. Your job, you're stable at your job. You have some reserve money set aside after you put down your down payment. Check with a realtor. Is it more cost effective for you and your family to rent versus buy? You know, go through all those things. And especially the last thing, are you going to be there for 3-4 years at minimum? Because if you're not, please guys, don't buy a house, because you're never going to recover the cost of the closing on the house, the realtor fees and all that other stuff. So if you're not going to be there at least 3 or 4 years, continue to rent, ride this out and then check at that time. But my assumption is this. You know, you're sitting on the sidelines with millions of other people, and when rates come out, and there was just a study done yesterday, they said, if mortgage rates get to 5%, the floodgates are going to open again. That's going to create FOMO again. What's going to happen? Well, you're going to see prices on houses go up again. So is all this really going to happen? Guys, really, we don't know. Okay, we're at the mercy of the economy, the world, the Fed, and everything else. So you have to make a decision on your own. Is it right timing for you? And if it is, you think it is, or you're just like, you know, we really don't know. How's our credit? How's all this other stuff? We would love to help you, and I'll give you all my information at the end of this video. But based on the information coming in today, what's going on with mortgage rates? So we go over to here. This is what I see on my screen on a daily basis. I follow the bond market. Why? Well, because it's telling me what's going on with mortgage rates. So we don't watch the 10-year treasury. That's a study from the old times. What we want to watch is the MBS market. And you're seeing that right in the middle of your screen right up here. The MBS market is basically a bond that trades on Wall Street, that's yield is the biggest part of your mortgage payment or your interest rate. So we're seeing on the screen right now, if you squint, you can see in the background, there's a plus 13. That's fantastic. All you need to know about this indicator right here is this is what's happening to the price of a mortgage-backed security bond. If the price is up, which you don't see very often in the last year, that means rates are coming down. There's a yin-yang effect, a flip-flop effect. If the price goes up, rates or yields come down. If the price goes down, rates and yields go up. So right now, even the bond markets are liking it and mortgage rates are going to ease a little bit. But yesterday we had some really bad news in the markets. And here's what we're seeing in regards to mortgage rates. These are the top six products people use when they're out there looking to buy or refinancing a home. These are rates issued by Mortgage News Daily. This isn't a bank's rate sheet. Basically, what Mortgage News Daily does on a daily basis is they send out questionnaires to banks all over the country and said, if you had to borrow with these five criterias, and what are they? Well, they're buying their first house. It's a single family home and it'll be their primary home. Is that you? Okay. So now their credit score is 740 and they're putting down 20%. That is the scenario that you're seeing on your screen. So do you need to put 20% down when you're buying your first house? Absolutely not. In most cases, you can get away with 3%. What if you're a veteran or you're looking in a rural area, you might be able to get away with USDA that requires 0% down. So you can most likely get into your first house with as little as 3 to 3.5%. If you're kicking the tires and you want to say, hey, Dan, how do I know? How can I talk to somebody that really does this for a living that can really help educate me with the numbers and everything else like that? Well, just reach out to us. My name is Dan Frio. I'm a mortgage advisor. I've been doing this for over 30 years. I've seen this market happen. I've seen the ups, the downs, the good, the bad, and the ugly. So I'd love to be able to consult with you and your family to see, you know, maybe to answer that question that I get on a daily basis. Should I buy now or should I continue to rent waiting for the housing crash and mortgage rates to come down? That's your decision, but I'm just giving you the tools to figure this out. So if we can be of any help, love to talk with you or work with you on your pre-approval. All you need to do is reach out to us, give us a call at 844-775-5626, or just click the apply now button. What's going to happen within 24 to 48 hours, you're going to be contacted by me or maybe one of my mortgage advisors to go over your application and just walk you through this whole process. So that's it for today, folks. So I hope you're planning on having a fantastic weekend. And I'll be back on Monday, believe it or not, even though next week's probably going to be really dead because of the 4th of July holiday. But I'll be back on Monday to give you guys a report on what's going on in the economy, the markets, and where in the heck the Fed Reserve is going to do at the next meeting. So take care, guys. Thanks so much for watching. God bless you. And I hope if you're out there looking for some help trying to buy your first house, you reach out to us and give us the opportunity to work with you. Take care. Have a fantastic weekend. Bye-bye.